Good morning. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. For these Sundays in the season of February, we are following our Savior Jesus as he teaches us from his Sermon on the Mount in Matthew chapter 5. Today he'll speak to us about being salt and light as we live for our Savior. We'll follow the order of service and word and sacrament. Let's sing the opening hymn. Please stand. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. God invites us to come into his presence and worship him with humble and penitent hearts. Therefore, let us acknowledge our sinfulness and ask him to forgive us. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this I deserve your punishment, both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior, Jesus Christ, I pray, Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given his one and only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. For all that we need in life and for the wisdom to use all your gifts with gratitude and joy, hear our prayer, O Lord. For the steadfast assurance that nothing can separate us from your love and for the courage to stand firm against the assaults of Satan and every evil, hear our prayer, O Christ. For the well-being of your holy church in all the world, and for those who offer here their worship and praise, hear our prayer, O Lord. Merciful God, maker and preserver of life, uphold us by your power and keep us in your tender care. The works of the Lord are great and glorious. His name is worthy of praise. Let us pray. Almighty God, you sent your one and only Son as the word of life for our eyes to see and our ears to hear. Help us believe what the scriptures proclaim about him and do the things that are pleasing in your sight. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Senior choir sings the anthem, God of Grace and God of Glory. The first lesson is from the Old Testament book of Joshua, chapter 24. The Lord had chosen Israel as his Old Testament people. He wanted them to let their light shine for his glory. In this part from Joshua's book, we hear the Israelites saying that they would make the Lord their only God. Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods your forefathers worshipped beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourselves this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your forefathers served beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord. Then the people answered, far be it from us to forsake the Lord to serve other gods. It was the Lord our God himself who brought us and our fathers up out of Egypt from that land of slavery and performed those great signs before our eyes. He protected us on our entire journey and among all the nations through which we traveled. And the Lord drove out before us all the nations, including the Amorites who lived in the land. We too will serve the Lord because he is our God. Joshua said to the people, you are not able to serve the Lord. He is a holy God. He is a jealous God. He will not forgive your rebellion and your sins. If you forsake the Lord and serve foreign gods, he will turn and bring disaster on you and make an end of you after he has been good to you. But the people said to Joshua, no, we will serve the Lord. Then Joshua said, you are witnesses against yourselves that you have chosen to serve the Lord. Yes, we are witnesses, they replied. Now then, said Joshua, throw away the foreign gods that are among you and yield your hearts to the Lord, the God of Israel. And the people said to Joshua, we will serve the Lord our God and obey him. This is the word of the Lord. The psalm of the day is Psalm 111, printed out on page 106. The senior choir will sing the verses. The Lord Jesus has made us his people who are to let our light shine for his glory. The Apostle Peter encourages us with these words from his first letter, chapter 2. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once you were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Dear friends, I urge you as aliens and strangers in the world to abstain from sinful desires which war against your soul. Live such good lives among the pagans that, though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us. This is the word of the Lord. Senior choir sings the verse of the day. We stand for the gospel lesson. Jesus teaches us in his Sermon on the Mount from chapter 5, verses 13 through 20. You are the salt of the earth, but if the salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled by men. You are the light of the world. A city on a hill cannot be hidden. Neither do people light a lamp and put it under a bowl. Instead, they put it on its stand, and it gives light to everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before men that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. I tell you the truth, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. Anyone who breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever practices and teaches these commands will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you that unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. This is the gospel of our Lord. You may be seated. Children, you're invited up to the front for the children's message.
Good morning, everybody. So I have a bucket of stuff here. I want you to take a look at it. Don't read that, Braden. Guess what's in here? What's that look like to you? Looks like salt. Can you see that? That's salt. Do you know what we use this for? We take this salt and we put it in a scooper like this. And when there's ice on the sidewalks, we throw that salt out on the ice. And you know what happens? The ice melts away, and it won't be slippery. So we throw this salt down so you won't fall over and slip. Now, that's how we use salt. There are many different uses for salt. But the Bible says today, you and I are to live like salt in the world. Now, what in the world does that mean? Does that mean we're to keep people from slipping? that we're to throw ourselves on the sidewalk? No, I don't think that's what it means. In Jesus' day, they used salt for something else. Do you know what they used salt for in Jesus' day? They used to use it to preserve their food. You think about if you had a turkey sandwich and you left it sit out all day, it would go bad, wouldn't it? It'd go rotten. So we put it in our refrigerators to keep it nice and fresh. Well, they didn't have refrigerators in Jesus' day. So they'd take their food, their meat, and they would roll it in salt. And that salt would keep it from going rotten. It would preserve it. You and I live like salt when we keep things from going rotten. Keep people from going rotten with sin. Now, how do we do that? We do that by sharing the good news of Jesus. So we live like salt as we tell people the good news that Jesus has loved us, that he died for us on the cross to take away all of our sins, and that he's going to keep us as his very own and take us to be with him in heaven. That's the good news that we share with people to keep them from being rotten with sin and getting thrown out. So let's live like salt and tell people about Jesus. Let's pray. Lord Jesus, we thank you for coming here and living perfectly in our place, dying for us on the cross to forgive us all of our sins, and then rising again. Lord, please help us to be like salt and to believe that message for ourselves and to share it with others. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The portion of God's Word for us to meditate on this morning is that gospel lesson taken from Matthew's Gospel. It's our continuation of our look at Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. Dear friends in Christ, last week we began discussing Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. That sermon is probably one of the most well-known sermons that Jesus ever preached that's recorded for us in Scripture. But it's also probably one of the most misused, misquoted, misapplied sermons that Jesus ever preached. See, many people have looked at the Sermon on the Mount as a formula of sorts. That if you follow this correctly, step by step, doing everything it says, then you will become a Christian. But in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus is not telling people, unbelievers, how to be Christians. Rather, he's talking to Christians, telling them how they are to be. There's a difference. He's not telling us how to be Christians, but how Christians are to be. And as Jesus began the Sermon on the Mount last week, we started by looking at the blessings that come to us as part of this Christian life. We look at the blessedness of following Christ. And what we begin to talk about today is how we live in response to those blessings we have. And today we hear that we are blessed, that Jesus has said to us, "You are salt and light." So let's talk about how we live as salt and light in this world. Salt is an essential mineral for us. In fact, if you were to go out and Google it on your computer or your smartphone, you'll find a website that says the top 60 uses of salt. I didn't know there were that many uses for salt in our modern day and age, but there are. Probably the two main uses of salt that I'm most familiar with are to melt the snow off my driveway, ice off my driveway, and to season my French fries. But there are many different uses for salt. It's an essential mineral. And it was just as essential for Jesus in his day. Because before they had upright freezers, salt was used as a preservative. Food from the market would not keep. It would spoil very quickly in that humid, arid climate. And so they would have to roll that food in salt to keep it from going rotten. And it's that preservative nature of salt that we want to focus on today as we talk about how we as Christians live as salt in the world. We live as salt when we prevent things from going bad with sin. When we stop the world from becoming rotten with sin. Let's talk about a number of different ways we can do this. First of all, we live as salt in the world when we refuse to go along with sin. Think about what would happen if everybody would refuse to go along with sinful behavior or refuse to be a willing observer to the immorality of our culture. Would that keep sin and immorality and wickedness from spreading so quickly in our day and age? I mean, think about what happens when businesses roll out policies that their customers are not in favor of. People boycott. They say, "We're not going to go along with this. We want nothing to do with it." And what happens? Those businesses begin to roll back those policies, or they don't spread them quite as quickly. They don't enforce them. Now, what would happen if we were to do that with the sin and immorality in our culture? Yes, it might not save anyone's soul, but it certainly might have an influence on how quickly that wickedness spreads. An example of this is Natalie Grant. Natalie Grant was a young Christian singer, is a young Christian singer. And in 2014, she was nominated for 2 Grammys for the songs that she sang. Now, that's a big honor. It's kind of like getting to the Super Bowl for music singers. So she went to the Grammy show. She went to the awards show. And while she was there, up on stage, she witnessed an act that was deeply offensive to her Christian faith because there were parts of that that were almost satanic. So then Natalie Grant had a choice. Do I sit here and be a passive observer to this immorality, or do I get up and walk out? She got up and walked out. Of this great honor, of this awards show, she just left. And people took notice. In fact, they took notice because they wrote about it afterwards. It was on the internet. It was a write-up in the newspaper. And Natalie Grant was interviewed and asked why she left. And she said, "Yes, we left the Grammys early. I have many thoughts, most of which are probably better left inside my head. But I'll say this. I've never been more honored to sing about Jesus and for Jesus. And I've never been more sure of the path I've chosen." Imagine what would have happened if every believer in the theater that night would have got up and walked out with Natalie Grant instead of being a willing, passive observer to that sin. Imagine what would have happened if every believer around the country would have just turned the TV off that instant as that happened. Let us live as salt in this world. I think another way that we can live as salt, number two, we can live as salt when our conversations are encouraging and uplifting to others, especially fellow believers. When our conversations are filled with the promises of God's word, and we talk about God's love for us in Christ, then we are acting as salt that is actually preserving each other, keeping us from becoming spoiled and rotten with sin, because we're pointing each other to the cross. When we listen to the hardships and the burdens that our fellow believers are carrying, and we try to encourage them with the promises of God's love and the promises from His word, then we are acting as salt. We try to love those who others have labeled unlovable, then we are living as salt in the world. The third and probably the most important way that we live as salt is when we proclaim and preserve the teaching of justification. When we proclaim and preserve the teaching of justification. Now I know, what's that? Justification, big fancy word that really, really comes down to the answer for this question. How can a sinner stand in a right relationship before God? How can a sinner stand in a right relationship before God? Now, what Jesus tells us today in our text is that we don't stand before God in a right relationship by what we do, by the good things that we do in our lives, by the way we live. Jesus made that clear at the very last part of our text for today, because he said, unless your righteousness surpasses that of the Pharisees and of the teachers of the law, you will not enter the kingdom of heaven. Which had to be a shocking statement, because in Jesus' day, you just didn't get any better in outward actions than the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. So Jesus says, unless the things we do surpass even that, there is no hope that we're getting into heaven on our own. So how do we then, as sinners, you and I, how do we stand in a right relationship before God? It is because Jesus was righteous in our place. He surpassed that righteousness of the Pharisees and Sadducees. He was absolutely perfect. Every demand that God would make of you and me, he nailed it, kept them all perfectly. And yet, our Heavenly Father punished Jesus for our failures, so that his anger over our sin was satisfied, so that because of what Jesus has done, God has declared you and me to be not guilty of sin. He has declared the world to be forgiven, not guilty. That is justification. So how do we stand right before God? Through faith in Jesus Christ, we are justified. So our hope of getting into the kingdom of heaven is not by what we do, it is our connection to Christ, who has died for us and rose again for us. That's our hope of heaven. So if we want to live as salt in this world, if we want to see sin stop from spreading as quickly, then we preserve that message and we proclaim that message. Because the only way to keep people from becoming rotten with sin is to change hearts. And the only way to change hearts is through the gospel of Jesus Christ, through that message of justification. That's what it means to live as salt. But not everyone is going to give us the opportunity to share that good news of Jesus with them. And that's why it's also important that we live as light in the world. Jesus said, "You are the light of the world." Now, just as salt was an essential mineral in Jesus' day, so light was essential. Because you couldn't go home and flip on the light switch and brighten your house up on a dark night. There was no electricity. So lamps and candlelight were very, very important. A lamp was the only thing that was going to brighten your home or give light to your path. Light was essential. And so, yes, it's important for us to be salt, to teach the message of Jesus Christ by his life, his death, his resurrection, to forgive us from all of our sins. But living, how we live, is also important. It's also important to be light in this world. See, not everyone is going to give us the chance to share Christ with them. And so we need to be able to demonstrate Christ in the way that we live. See, people will stand back and they're going to watch us. And they'll say, why should I listen to that person? What makes them different than the rest of the world? Are they different from the rest of the world? So when we don't have an opportunity to tell people about Christ, we need to show them Christ in the way that we live. Some people have said it this way: preach the gospel at all times. Use words when necessary. You've probably have heard that statement. Sometimes it's falsely attributed to St. Francis of Assisi. I like it better the way Jesus said it. Jesus said in our text, "You are the light of the world. Let your light shine before men, that they may see your good deeds and praise your Father in heaven." I think there are two things we want to talk about as we consider living in as light in the world. Number one, Jesus is really the light of the world. He is the one who came here and lived a perfect and righteous life in our place. He is the one who died and rose again to shatter the darkness of sin and the grip that that darkness had on this world. Jesus, by his life, death, and resurrection, broke the darkness of sin, death, and the devil. Without a doubt, he is the light of the world. We are the light of the world in that we reflect that light of Christ in our lives. We are the light in the world in the sense that Christ shines through us. So when people look at the way we live, do they see Christ? Are we displaying Christ in our kindness to others? Are we shining with Christ's grace and with his unconditional forgiveness? Can people see Christ in the fact that we are willing to help others even when it means we have to sacrifice our own desires and our own needs? Let's think about it this way. Consider the moon. The moon reflects the sun's light. That's one of its main purposes. And when the moon gives its entire surface to reflecting the light of the sun, it is this dominant bright light in the nighttime sky. Let us give all of our surface, all that we are, and our thoughts, words, and actions to reflecting Christ in our lives. That is how we will live as light in this world. The second thing we think we need to consider is that as we live as the light, we do it for the glory of God. God is the one who is glorified, not us in this. We don't live as light to make ourselves better than others. We don't live as light so that people look up to us and honor us. We don't do it to earn heaven or even to make ourselves feel good like maybe we somehow deserved the forgiveness we have. We live as light to bring glory to God and to lead others to do the same. Now, perhaps as you've listened to this discussion about what it means to be salt and light, perhaps you felt a little bit of a burden. Perhaps you felt that pressure of living as salt and light in the world. And perhaps that burden feels even heavier when we take an honest look at our lives and say, there are times when we have not been too salty, and there are times when that light has not shined too brightly in us. Where instead of speaking the truth, we kept quiet. Instead of walking away from sin, we joined in it. Instead of stopping it, we started it. Not too salty, not too bright. And when we can look at our lives and we see those instances where we have failed to live as salt and light, we begin to feel the guilt of that. And we feel fear. We fear Jesus' words where he said, if salt loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled by men. Perhaps that's an unspoken fear we have. That because we've failed in our thoughts, words, and actions, we are no longer good in service to God, that we are useless, just cast aside. God has moved on from us. If that's ever a fear we have, let me share with you again Jesus' words, because Jesus' words will break that burden and they will give you hope. Because Jesus has said, you are the salt. You are salt. He has said, you are the light of the world. Jesus did not say, you will become salt when you are good enough. He did not say, when you do the right things, then you become light. He said, you are salt. You are light. And in that one little word, that three little word, that little linking verb, there is the promise of the gospel. See, on our own, we are far less than salt. We have lost our saltiness. On our own, we are darkness. There is no light in us. On our own, we are attached to that evil that we are to resist. We are attached to that evil that Christ came to destroy. But we are not on our own. We have Christ. In your baptisms, Christ has claimed you to be his own. He wrapped himself around you and made you his brother and sister. He has given you his righteousness to stand before God with. He has made you to be salt. He has let his light shine in you, that it can be shining through you and be reflected in your life. And through God's word and sacraments, he will continue to strengthen you so that you can live as salt and light. See, no fear, no burden, no pressure. In God's word, you just are empowered. Through the gospel, you are empowered to live in response to all these amazing blessings that come to you through Christ. In God's word, you are empowered to live as he has made you to be. And today, Jesus has said, you are salt and you are light. Amen. Please stand. Now may the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen. Let us continue our worship this morning by joining together in reciting the words of the Nicene Creed. We join together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became fully human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who in unity with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. You may be seated. We continue by giving our offerings to the Lord. Also, please take a moment to fill out the friendship register and pass that down to the person next to you.
Let's stand to pray. We give thee but thine own, whate'er the gift may be. All that we have is thine alone, a trust, O Lord, from thee. May we thy bounties thus as stewards true receive, and gladly as thou blessest us, to thee our first fruits give. Amen. We include in our prayers this morning two intercessions. First of all, a prayer for Stephen Schrader. He is the son of Rachel Schrader from our congregation. Stephen is an Army helicopter pilot, was involved in a serious crash this past week, and is hospitalized in Tennessee. We also pray for retired Pastor Walter Schumann, who broke his hip this past week and had surgery at Watertown Hospital. Let us pray. Lord Jesus Christ, you are the light of the world. Help us to follow you that we may never walk in darkness. Through your means of grace, shine on us that we may reflect your light to the world. Let our actions in life lead people to you, not away from you. Let them lead others to give you praise, not contempt. And give us opportunity to share the good news of your life, death, and resurrection, that we might be salt in this world. Let our speech preserve peace and joy as the gospel is spread and your kingdom is enlarged. We ask this for your glory, not for our own. Gracious Savior, in your wisdom, you have permitted your servant Stephen Schrader, Rachel's son, to be injured in a helicopter accident. While we do not fully understand your purpose, we are fully confident in your love for Steve and his family, and in your promise to use all things for his good. We thank you for sparing his life and pray that you would permit him to quickly and fully recover according to your will. Give Steve patience and faith that will lead him to joyfully and thankfully submit to your care and the guidance in your word. Loving Savior, in your mercy, you provide physical healing for believers. We praise you for your mercy shown to Pastor Walter Schumann in bringing him through surgery. Bless his body with healing and allow him a speedy recovery. Keep his faith in you firm as he trusts you to bless his body and soul with all that they need. Lord Jesus, you call all who are weary and burdened to come to you for rest. Rejoicing in your grace, we now come to this heavenly feast in which you give your children on earth your true body and blood to eat and to drink. Remove from us the dirty garments of self-righteousness and sin, and clothe us with the righteousness purchased by your blood. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for you and for one another, and after this life, grant us a place at your heavenly table. We offer all of our petitions in your name, as in your name we also pray together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We turn to page 33. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Praise to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In love, he has blessed us with every spiritual blessing. In the past, he spoke to us through the prophets, but in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son, who is the radiance of his glory. Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and thanks and honor and glory forever and ever. We stand to sing Thank the Lord on page 36. Hear the prayer of your people, O Lord, that the lips which have praised you here may glorify you in the world, that the eyes which have seen the coming of your Son may long for his coming again, and that all who have received in his true body and blood the pledge of your forgiveness may be restored to live a new and holy life, through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Brothers and sisters, go in peace, live in harmony with one another, serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. You may be seated. We thank the Trinity Senior Choir for using their voices to glorify our Savior here in his sanctuary. Please note the next two Sundays are some special events coming up. We have our annual voters meeting next Sunday after the second service. A highlight of that meeting will be a report from the three committees studying a number of issues regarding our school. And then 2 weeks from today, we'll have our annual all-member potluck. So that means it's for everybody. It's an occasion to get to meet some of the new members here at Trinity and join together with their brothers and sisters in the faith and enjoy good Christian fellowship. There is a whole page in the bulletin with details about the AMP coming up in 2 weeks. God bless your day and your week ahead as you let your light shine for Christ.